If you'd like to, you can open your songbooks to number 480. 480, I believe that's the number for Blessed Assurance. I made this statement a few weeks ago. As a matter of fact, I know it was my first Sunday here on the first, when we considered the sermon In Christ Alone, that a reference to a song in a sermon, or even, to take it to the extreme, an entire sermon built around a song, can, if we allow it to, stir up a real emotional impact. There's a reason that songs trigger emotions so well. You can hear a song on the radio and it can immediately take you back to high school or to dating or to marriage, that is, first getting married, etc. Because songs have an emotional connection with the one singing them. You have to almost let your inhibitions go to sing a song. You have to kind of switch off that wall that we tend to put up and kind of just allow ourselves to sing, if you will. A song can remind us of cherished memories. A song can motivate us morally. A song can move us emotionally, but we have to let our guard down for that to happen. With the kind of power, then, that a song has, I think it is important for us as Christians to understand the songs that we sing in worship, to have a better appreciation for the songs that we bring to the Father up in heaven. We need to know what it is that we're singing. We need to have a better appreciation for the words specifically that we're singing, and a biblical understanding of the psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs that we present in worship every Sunday and throughout the week. The launching verse, I suppose you could call it that, for the sermon is Colossians 3:16, wherein Paul calls singing a teaching tool. He says that we are to admonish one another, teaching one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. I look at those three different descriptions of singing and song, even though the word song is included. But I look at those three as three different things. When we sing with psalms, I take that to mean we sing scripture. We do that on occasion. We take scripture, we put it to music, and we sing it. Hymns, I think those are songs that glorify God. And then we have spiritual songs, songs that we sing in order to encourage and to edify each other. So with our singing that we sing regularly whenever Christians gather to worship, we do this because we understand the significance of song emotionally and intellectually, but also not just because it's commanded, but because of what is commanded. We're commanded to exalt the Father. We're commanded to know the Bible as we sing the Scripture and to encourage one another. So if there's that much importance given to singing in Scripture, then I think we need to know what it is that we're singing. We need to know the words that we're singing, whether they're true or not. If singing is teaching, Colossians 3:16, that if I'm going to be taught by you, I need to make sure that my teacher knows what he's talking about. If you're going to be taught by me when I sing to you and you sing to me, then you need to know that I know what I'm teaching is true or not. So what I wanted us to do is 7 or 8 times a year, not a whole lot overall, is take a song that we have in our songbooks, a song that we all know probably very well, and study that song. Now, as I said, we did that when we considered the song In Christ Alone on my first Sunday. The difference is, In Christ Alone is not a song that we have in our songbooks. It's not a song we typically sing. And we did not actually sing that song for the previously stated reasons. So what I want us to do this morning is take a song that we do know very well. That song is Blessed Assurance. You have it there in front of you probably in your songbooks, 480. And so what we're going to do is we're going to consider the words found in that song, Blessed Assurance, and let those words lead us through a study of the Bible. Very simple. It'll feel different, but really it's just another sermon about Blessed Assurance. It's a sermon that we're going to study from the Bible about our confidence that we have salvation in Christ. We're just going to let certain phrases found in that song bring out the text and texts that we're going to study. Now, the way we're going to do this is, after a point or two of the sermon, Brother Greg, who's on the front row, is going to stand up, our song leader, and lead us into or through the first verse of the song. The purpose being, after we have studied the words found in the first verse, then we're going to sing the first verse. And hopefully, when we're singing it, even though we've sung this song probably 10,000 times in our lives, hopefully, having just studied the words biblically, we can have that much more of appreciation for them as we sing them, and thus we can teach each other better. But let's just set up the topic at hand first. All Christians are supposed to have blessed assurance. It's not just something that if you get it, if you have it, if you understand the concept, then that's good. It's just a bonus for being a Christian. No, all Christians are supposed to have blessed assurance. All Christians ought to know, K-N-O-W, that they are saved and are going to go to heaven when they die. 1 John 5:13, John says, so that you may know, not hope, not guess, not think, not cross your fingers, but so that you may know you have eternal life. I know that if you put a bullet in my brain before I hit the ground, I'm going to heaven. The apostles who preached so zealously and so faithfully the message of Christ, despite the fear of death, that was far more apparent than it is for Americans. Paul, for example, in 1 Timothy 4, knew that when, as he wrote about his final days, that when the blade slashed through his neck, before his severed head hit the ground, his soul would be in paradise. He didn't just guess. He didn't just hope. He knew it. He had blessed assurance. And so we need to ask the question, how can I, the Christian, know that I'm going to go to heaven when I die? How can I, the Christian, know I have blessed assurance? Well, first of all, because Jesus is yours. Or as we individually would sing, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Because Jesus is mine, I have blessed assurance. Now, what is Jesus? Well, Jesus is, that's a big question, right? That's a big, huge, all-encompassing topic, but let's individualize it. What is Jesus to me? Jesus is mine, I sing with blessed assurance. First of all, Jesus is my Savior. When the prophet Isaiah walked into the throne of King Ahaz, a king who was supposed to have been faithful to God, he was from the tribe, he was from the nation of Judah, the more faithful of the two that had split off and had gone into civil war, and then the north had eventually gone into captivity of Assyria. The southern kingdom of Judah was supposed to be the more faithful of the two. King Ahaz was supposed to be leading his people through a faithful life in God. Instead, King Ahaz, weary and fearful of Assyria coming and taking them to captivity, starts making alliances. He starts making up deals, like politicians do, with other nations, including Egypt and others. And so Isaiah goes to the king and he says, if you would just ask God for a sign, then God would show you that He will take care of you. If you will just ask God for some sign that God is looking out for you, His faithful people, then He'll show it to you. But Ahaz is stubborn. And so he says, Isaiah 7:13, I will not ask God for a sign. No, I don't think I should be so presumptuous. So Isaiah says, the Lord will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and bear a son, and they will call His name Emmanuel, God with us. You have a Savior coming, Ahaz. If you would just let go and trust in God, your Savior's on His way. And when He came, Matthew 1:21, the angel told Joseph to call the boy Jesus. Why? Because He will save His people from their sins. Jesus, from the same root word as Joshua. Joshua, the word means Jehovah is salvation. Well, why should I call Him Jesus? Because Jehovah is salvation. Salvation has come in a person. Salvation has come in a body. Your Savior's here. So call His name Jesus. And when He was born, Luke 2:11, the angel said, unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Jesus is our Savior. And so we have blessed assurance because Jesus is mine. Me personally. You personally for you. Our Savior. But that's not all. I want you to think about the significance of that. For 1,000+ years, God had given a law on Mount Sinai, a law that was not done away with until Jesus Himself died on the cross, Colossians 2:14. So for 1,000+ years, the nation of Israel had a law that said, if you sin, then a holy God, that is God, cannot have any kind of fellowship with you, the unholy being. And so you must rectify your sin with God. Well, the way that they did that under the old law of Moses was to take an animal, a lamb, take it to the high priest, have that lamb be killed, and that lamb would represent the person. Because the penalty for sin is supposed to be death, Romans 6. So because the wages of sin is death, if I've sinned so that I don't die, I kill an animal. And he dies for me. You can read that in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and then see it applied all throughout the Old Testament. Well, imagine being then a young Jewish boy. You finally understood the difference between right and wrong. You've committed your first real sin, and you recognize then that you have now defiled your soul before God. And so you read the law that God gave you at Sinai. You follow the law to the letter. You take your animal. You take it to the priest. You kill that animal. And the priest says, you have done to the T exactly what you were supposed to do. And then there's a pause, and he says, but you're still a sinner. Because this lamb, this animal, this goat cannot take away your sins. Because a goat didn't sin. You, a perfect person, became imperfect. You, a perfect man, sinned, becoming imperfect. And so the only thing that can die to take away your sins is a perfect man. And so, Mark 1:15, as John the Baptist was preaching, he saw Christing over the hill, Jesus of Nazareth. And he said, "Behold, turn your eyes upon him. Behold, the Lamb of God." What does it mean, the Lamb of God? Well, you see, if I was under the old law and I sinned, I would offer a lamb. It'd be the Lamb of Matthew. This is the lamb that represents me who sinned. Well, this is the lamb offered by, not me, this is the lamb offered by God against whom I sinned. Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. In other words, in one word, saves. And then what do? We killed him. We put him on a cross, as we studied in class this morning, and we executed him as though he were the lowest of all scum of criminals. We put him on a cross and killed him. And Satan no doubt thought that all the hope that we had put in Jesus Christ as he watched him die, as he watched him be buried, as he watched the tomb cross over, or the boulder cross over the tomb, Satan thought that he had won, that he had crushed our hope. And then 3 days later, our Savior rose. And because of that, we can have blessed assurance because he's our Savior. But that's not all. We have blessed assurance because Jesus is mine. He is my King. We have used this phrase 1,000 times. Jesus is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. It comes from Revelation 17:14. Imagine though hearing that at the time when Revelation was written, when the Christians were living in hiding, Christians living in caves, Christians living in secret, because the Roman Empire was so mercilessly attacking and slaughtering you for just wearing the name of Christ. And you have the king of the world, Caesar, the most powerful king that existed at the time, putting his thumb of tyranny down on the church. John then writes about Christ and about the victory in Jesus and how he is king over kings, how he is lord over lords. The point being, let them kill you. If they're going to kill you, so be it. You have a king greater than King Caesar. You don't bow the knee to him. Jesus is my king over every other king. And that's why, as we talked in class, Jesus would not say that he was a king on earth. That's why Jesus never recognized any kind of title of king on earth. When they tried to hoist him on their shoulders and make him a king, John 6, he refused. In fact, he got the boat and took off so that people wouldn't take him. Because he was not going to be a king on earth. He's not going to lower himself to being just the king of some nation of people. He is the king over kings and lord over lords. Paul says, 1 Timothy 6:15, that he is the one and only, the King James uses the word potentate. That's an old word. It just means the one who sits on the throne of authority. There is only one person in religion, or Christian religion, or well, any religion, because Christianity is the only truth. There is only one person who has the authority to sit on a throne and make decrees about my faith, and that's Jesus Christ, my only King. And so because I have a King who never dies, who never turns radical or tyrannical or any other thing, I have blessed assurance. Number three, blessed assurance because Jesus is my Redeemer. Redeemer, the word means one who buys you back. But that's only one definition. You know, if you go to the store and you purchase something, you redeem it for a cost. You buy a pack of gum, it costs you, you know, 75 cents. That's the redeemed price. You have to pay the price to receive the gum. But there's a second meaning to redemption. And it's embodied in a knight in shining armor. You know, who swoops in, who slays the dragon, who saves the princess, and who saves the day. That's also what Jesus is to us. He is our Redeemer. He came in and he slayed the dragon. He defeated sin so that we might be freed from it. Romans 6:16-17. All those who sin become servants of sin. And so praise be to God who frees us from it. But it is true that the word redemption means to buy back. And so as God and Satan had to make a purchase and exchange for my soul, what was the price that was paid for my soul? You know, Jesus always says, or he said it repeatedly, that the most important soul in the world is the individual soul. My soul is more important than any other soul in the world. Because I can save the whole world and lose my soul, and that's not worth it. My soul is important. My soul is important to me. But ask this question, how much is my soul worth to God? It was worth enough to send his son to die for me. Titus 2:14, he gave himself so that he might redeem us, buy us back from Satan. And so we sing, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's my Savior. He's my King. He's my Redeemer. He's my Mediator. Hebrews 7:24-26. When the writer talks about the old law of Moses and those old high priests and how you would have a high priest under the law who would serve in that function until he died. And then when he died, everything started over. You had a new high priest. And then when he died, it started over. You had a new high priest. And how much better it is to be a Christian that you have a one, never dying, never changing high priest who can mediate between me and God. You see, I don't want you mediating between me and God. You do not want me standing between you and God on the judgment day. There is no human being, there is no person on planet Earth that you want between you and God. There's no woman, there's no man, there's no bishop, no priest, no anybody other than Jesus Christ. He is the only mediator that we need between God and man. So, Jesus is mine. Because of that, we have blessed assurance. Last one at this point, and we move on. Jesus is mine because he's my friend. Now you read John 3:16. As I say the words, you have it in your brain because everybody in the world knows that verse. Even if you hate Christ, you know the verse, John 3:16. And when you read John 3:16, you can't help but see how much you want to be his friend. Oh, I want to be the friend of Jesus. I will be his friend. Why? Because he died for me. 1 John 3:16, he gave his life for me. I want to be his friend, but why would he want to be my friend? I'm the reason he had to die. I'm the one who sinned against him. I'm the one who betrayed him. I'm the one who belittled him. I'm the one who blasphemed against him. Why would he want to be my friend? Romans 5:6-8. When I, read it about that way. Read it. He says we, but put it you. When I was without strength, in due time Christ died for me, the ungodly. For rarely for a righteous man will someone die. On occasion, for a good man, some might dare to die, but God committed his love toward me, and that while I was still a sinner, Christ died for me. You know, I might die for a good man. I might die for someone who might think he's going to go out about and do some good for the world. I might be willing to sacrifice my life. That's a rare thought for someone to have. But Jesus had that thought when I was not a good man. Jesus was willing to come and to live and to die for me when I was not worth dying for. Because of that, he is mine. Friend, Jesus is mine, and so we have blessed assurance. But I want to stay with the first verse. Move on to the second point, and then we're going to sing the first verse in the chorus. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Why? Because I am an heir of salvation, purchase of God. Isn't that what your song says in verse 1? We're heirs of salvation, and because we are the heirs of salvation, H-E-I-R-S, the heirs of salvation, we have blessed assurance. Christians are the recipients of the greatest inheritance that we can ever fathom. It is not a trust fund. It is not a land inheritance. It is not money. It is an inheritance that is not of this world. It is out of this world. John 14:1-7 or so. When Jesus was speaking with his disciples. John 13, he had just finished telling them once again that he was going to go and die. Now, if you heard that your best friend in all the world and in heaven itself was going to go and die, wouldn't that make you a little sad? And so he opens John 14:1 with, "Let not your heart be troubled. Why? You believe in God, believe also in me. Blessed assurance. In my Father's house are many mansions." That's the King James. Now, I know the word mansions literally is rooms. And I know there are people who have a problem saying that because they don't like to think that there's just a room waiting for us. That we like to think we have a mansion waiting for us. Well, let's not get too materialistic. He's not being literal here. The point he's making is the house of God is so big that the rooms you can call mansions. Does that make you feel better? There's a lot of room available for everybody up in heaven. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it wasn't so, I would have told you. I go. Now that makes them sad, but then he says, I go and prepare a place for you. Now follow him logically. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. He's setting up, he's building for us something we stand to inherit after we leave this world. Now he says, where I go you know, and the way you know, which causes Philip to say, Lord, or Thomas to say, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. Where are you going? To the Father. Where are you taking me to? To the Father. No man comes to the Father but by me. And that's when Philip says, Lord, show us the Father, and that will suffice us. That will be enough. Oh, is that all it takes? Just to show you God? And so Philip said, or Jesus says to Philip, have I been so long with you that you don't know me? To have seen me is to have seen the Father. What are you going to do, Lord, to take you to God? Who is he? God. When he leaves this world, I'm going to go back to him. That's my inheritance I stand to receive. Paul had confidence in that. 2 Timothy 4, 6-8. I alluded to it. Let's read it. 2 Timothy 4, 6-8. This is the last thing Paul had ever written, this letter to Timothy. I don't know when he died. It could have been 6 years, 6 weeks, or 6 hours after he finished writing this letter. But he's about to die. He knows it. And so he says, I am now ready to be offered. The word means to be poured out like an offering, like it would have been done in the old law. I'm ready to be sacrificed for the cause of Christ. The time of my departure is at hand. But he says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course or the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is. Not I hope there is. Not there may be if I'm lucky. Henceforth, there is blessed assurance. Laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me that day, but not to me only, but to all them who love his appearing. There is laid up for me a crown. And so I know, we can know we have blessed assurance because Jesus is ours and because we are the heirs of salvation. Now we know it. Now let's sing it and make the words mean something. Brother Greg, lead us in verse 1 in the chorus. We can have blessed assurance. We can make those words mean something. Not just because they sound pretty, not just because the tune is beautiful, but because the words mean something. Now we have blessed assurance. Let's move on. We're almost done with the sermon. Point number 3. Because we have perfectly submitted to His will. That's the start of verse 2 and 3 in your psalm book. Perfect submission. Now perfect submission doesn't mean that you were perfect, or that you are perfect, or that you even can be perfect. The very fact that we need a Savior means we've already messed up. So even if we, from this moment on, never ever made another mistake, we can still not say we're perfect, because we've already messed up. None of us is perfect. The word perfect there as it's used, and now as commonly used in the Bible, means complete, total. Now, complete doesn't mean without flaw. Complete means you've done everything you can do. You can't be perfect, but you can do everything you can do to submit to the will of God. Jesus said in the verse we just read, John 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Him. Well, Jesus has given us the way. Now, that's not just to say, well, it's just Jesus, because what does that mean? Jesus, who is the way, has left us the instructions that we must follow if we want to get to the Father, where He's taking us to. But we have to obey those instructions completely, or to use the old word, perfectly. That means we can't change anything that doesn't suit our interest. We can't alter anything to make it more appealing. We can't cut anything out because we don't like certain people and we want to push them away. We can't expand anymore because we're drawing more people. We have to just take what He gave us as He gave it to us and just follow it. And if I follow it completely, and if you follow it completely, we have fellowship with one another. And we will get to heaven someday. And to quote the psalm, we will have, by following and completely serving God the way we're supposed to, when we get to heaven, we will have visions of rapture bursting on our side. You know what the word rapture means? If you just put the definition to the word, it means to have exuberant emotion. Now, rapture is a word that has been taken and has changed to mean something else. I'm interested in what people have changed it to mean. I'm interested in what the word actually means. The word rapture means exuberant emotion. It's this. When you're so excited about something, you can't even formulate words. You just stare dumbfounded with a grin on your face. That's rapture. And what's going to happen because we have completely obeyed God is we are going to go to judgment, and Jesus is going to say, He's not perfect, but He's with me. And we will go in and we will see heaven. We will see the face of God. We will breathe in celestial air, and we will have visions of rapture just bursting on our side. Why? Because we perfectly submitted to His will. John wrote, 1 John 2:3, hereby do we know that we know Him. If we, now what is the rest of it? Hereby do we know. Tell me, you say you're a Christian, yeah? You know Him? How do you know that you know Him? Because you feel it right here? No. You don't go by your gut instinct in Christianity. Christianity is not a feeling religion. Now, if you do it right, you will have some wonderful positive feelings. That's what the word rapture means. Exuberant emotion. But my Christianity is not based on how good I feel. Because you wake up on a Sunday morning and it's pouring down rain, you may not feel like worshiping God. But you're supposed to. Why? Not because of your feeling, but because somebody told you to, and you obey a commandment. John said in 1 John 2:3, hereby do you know that you know Him. Here's how you know that you know that you know that you know. If you keep His commandments. I can obey God. And in obeying God perfectly, that is completely, I can have visions of rapture bursting on my side. Blessed assurance, perfect submission leads to perfect delight. Now we know it. Now let's sing. Verse 2 in the chorus, please, Brother Green. Okay, we're going to wrap it up, and then we're going to sing the third verse, and then we'll offer the invitation. To summarize, I know I am saved. And there's nothing arrogant about that at all. There is nothing condescending about that, because we said at the beginning, all Christians ought to know that they're saved. It has nothing to do with thinking more of myself than I should, because if I obey the commandments, John says that I can know that I know Him. And you can know that you know Him as well. You can know that you're saved. And you can have blessed assurance. And in having blessed assurance, to summarize, all will be at rest. That doesn't mean you won't have problems in this world, because this world is just filled with problems. And God never said, if you follow me, if you obey me, I'll take away all your problems. No, He said all your problems will be worth it. That means something to come will be worth it. But while I'm here, while I'm suffering, while there's grief, heartache, pain, and distress, I have to endure it. But Jesus never said either, I will take away your tears on earth. He did say, I will take away your tears in heaven. That's another song we can study sometime. But that knowledge, that assurance that I have, that this life is worth it if I endure it, gives me peace on earth. So it lets me say, despite my problems now, I have something better waiting for me. And to put that down, let's just quote Jesus. Matthew 5, 3 through 12. Because I am saved, or as the song says, I am my Savior and happy and blessed, what do I have expected from me? Matthew 5, 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, they will be comforted. To come, eventually, you're mourning now, comfort's coming. Blessed are the meek, they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, they will be filled. Blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, because they will be called children of God. Blessed are the merciful, they will obtain mercy. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you. Notice how He changes it. It was abstract, now He makes it personal. It was, blessed are the peacemakers. Well, am I a peacemaker, am I not? I've got to think about it. So He makes it about you. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and say evil of you and speak evil and falsely against you for my name's sake. You rejoice and be exceeding glad. Why? Because great is your reward, not on earth, but in heaven. So persecuted the prophets which were before you. You can have blessed assurance. If you obey God, this world will be worth it. It will give you rest, and it will make you blessed. Now we know it. Now let's sing it. Verse 3 of the chorus, in the song. I know this was different. Sometimes different is okay. I don't think we did anything that was unscriptural, or we wouldn't have done it. And hopefully, let's say in 6 months, we just hear the song. Maybe we'll have a better appreciation for the words that we sing on that occasion. As we close, I want to offer a question. Are you, like the song says, born of the Spirit? John 3:3-5. Are you washed in His blood? Acts 22:16. Are you filled with His goodness? Romans 15:14. Are you lost in His love? I love that expression in the song. It's my favorite one. Are you just lost in His love? 1 John 4:19. If you're not, then why not this morning become a child of God? By repenting of sins, by confessing your faith in Him, and being immersed into Him so that God can take away your sins. If you are a child of God, but you have not been faithful, you have stopped thinking and caring about your Savior to the point where your assurance or your blessedness is not so sure because of your own life. Change your life. Take care of it today so that you can sing with joy, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. We're going to sing an invitation song now to encourage you. If you need to respond, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.